It's absolutely fantastic to have you here with us in London tonight. For fans who haven't had a chance to experience the film yet, can you just tell us a little bit about the concept behind it and where you took your inspiration?
Well, it's a big, beautiful film with amazing imagery from 25 countries that we shot over 5 years.
We visited as a nonverbal guided meditation on the themes of birth, death, and rebirth.
Those are very big themes. How did you go about whittling down what was going to make it into the final cut? Because there is some truly extraordinary imagery in the film.
Well, it's researching. We're researching imagery that rises to a really high level of visual interest that's based on the concept and themes of the treatment.
I mean, for fans who haven't seen the film yet, what kind of stuff have you got in there? What are they going to get to see?
Well, once we had the opening and closing of the film, which is the sand mandala that was created by the monks, and then we take it away at the end, it sets up the theme of the film, which is impermanence. And you're going to get a lot of strong, powerful images that break that flow, and you're going to get images that are the opposite, quite beautiful.
I think audiences will all have their favorite sections. Are there any particular passages of footage that have really stuck with you and you've really taken something specific away from?
Well, you know, I think when I think about the imagery, I think about the imagery and collecting it and all the challenges that we had doing that, and some of the aerial sequences that we got in Myanmar over the temples was just spectacular footage that we're very lucky to get.
What was the toughest sequence of footage to put together?
Well, by far to film was the sulfur mine in Indonesia. That we almost got gassed down there. We were very close to where they were harvesting this sulfur, and that wind changed, and so this sulfuric acid mist just about did us in.
We're very glad it didn't. Obviously, I think whilst the imagery is spectacular, the music really lends a lot to the film. Can you talk a little bit about the selection process for the sound of the film?
Well, it's 50-50. The film is, you know, these 70-millimeter images, and then the other half is the music, which is really kind of the emotional dialogue content.
We had composers we work with on Baraka, Michael Stearns and Lisa Gerard, and also Marcello Di Francesi. And having worked with them before, they know the kind of music we're trying to get to and the kind of feeling we're trying to attain with the music, which is very spacious and allows the viewer some space to bring their own inner dialogue to the viewing experience.
I mean, you mentioned there the fact that the film is shot on 70mm. Can you talk a little bit about what motivated that decision? And for film fans who maybe aren't quite familiar with that, what kind of a different effect that gives to the finished cinematography?
Well, technically it's really 65mm. But since there's no main character or scenes that you used to follow in a film, our main character is the image. So we used it to bring out the essence of the places and the portraits we shot. 70mm, 65 is just unbeatable. It's quality and it's sense of detail.
From a production point of view, does that add any additional challenges to capturing the images?
Well, you know, nowadays it's harder to move film stock in and out of countries and borders than it's ever been with X-ray concerns. So it's very challenging to do that. We were able to get it done. It's just not a process that's getting any easier.
I guess it's a big question, but as accomplished and successful documentary filmmakers, what do you think documentary film gives audiences that they don't get from the standard blockbuster fare that they maybe are used to?
Well, you know, documentaries can go places and show you things, show you the world in a way that feature films can't. Perhaps there's too many people chasing each other with guns in feature films, I don't know, but I love documentaries, and what it gives me is a view, sometimes unordinary views, of things we all know.
I just would say that just when you know that it's non-fiction imagery, it has a different resonance within you than I think something that is more entertaining, more entertainment. And so, I think it's a profound way, profound type of filmmaking to view.
I mean, like you've said, this film touches on a lot of different, very big themes. Is there a particular message overall or anything that you're really hoping audiences are going to take away from the film when they get a chance to see it tonight and in general?
The whole film is based on this power of flow. I mean, flow meaning the interconnection of things. And that's hopefully what you feel We tried to steer it away from too narrative of a side and just kind of run it down the middle so that you can experience this guided meditation. And it's based on flow and showing the interconnection of things.
I would just say, you know, as Ron said, it's meant to be a feeling inner experience, not about delivery of information or data. And staying away from a strong point of view, a political point of view, or things are good or bad. It's just trying to show the essence of those imagery, that imagery.
It's a stunning piece of work. I guess I should let you go and enjoy the rest of your evening, but is there another project in mind for you already? I mean, you've just completed this mammoth task, but is there anything else you're already thinking about?
Well, there's another world epic out there for sure. The world's a beautiful place. It's just amazing things there.
Just need a couple weeks off and we'll be ready.
Okay, I'll remember that. A couple of weeks.